Good morning. I invite you to stand with your hearts or with your posture for our call to worship this morning. God of hope, we see your love poured out for us and all the world. Teach us to live together as one community, human and beyond human. All are created to your glory, so your love is known among all the living. Let's sing together, Draw the Circle Wide. Suzanne's here to help with our time for all ages. Thank you so much. So the young in hearts are welcome to come forward and have this moment.
Oh, goody.
I hope it's just us.
You do?
I don't. Oh, well, maybe it is just you. Okay, come on down here where I can see you in that case.
Yes.
Right there. Kelvin, right down here where I can see you. Okay, so I guess we should introduce ourselves since there's hardly any of us. Tell us your name and where you're from. You don't know your name? What's your name?
Gavin.
Where are you from?
Crespo.
Right. Where are you from? Okay, you'll be the no-name kid. Who are you?
Addy.
Where are you from?
Crespo.
Okay, today we're talking about... Hey, I need... There's three of you, and this is not going to happen, okay? Because I'm the boss of us three. So, today we're going to talk about something called the prodigal son. How many of you are sons? Do you know? Yeah, if you're a boy and you have a dad, you're a son. Well, even if you don't have a dad, you're a son. Right, so you're sons. When we're gonna keep our hands to ourselves. Okay, so the prodigal son was this guy who, there was a dad, and he had two sons, kind of like your dad, his name is John, right? And one of the sons, the older one, was a nice guy. The younger son just was never happy. He always wanted to have lots of money and travel and see the world and do all kinds of fun stuff. So one day he went up to his dad and he said, okay, Dad, can I have my inheritance? Do you know what an inheritance is? When you die, you leave your everything you own to some people, and that means you inherit it. So if when I die, if I have a ring that you particularly want, I could make sure that you get that ring. Okay? So that would be your inheritance. So the second son went over to the dad and said, I want my inheritance now. And the dad was pretty rich, so he said, okay. He didn't think it was going to be a very good idea, but he did it anyways, because he's the dad and he loved his kid. So have you ever done something that your dad didn't think was a good idea?
Yes.
Yes?
Like what? You don't have to tell. Anyway.
What?
Okay. All right. So anyhow, so the guy left. The kid took all the money, and he left, and he went out, and he partied, and he had lots of money. He had lots of friends. He traveled all over the world. He was quite the big shot until, what do you suppose happened? He didn't die. He ran out of
money.
And then how many friends did he have when he was poor?
Zero.
Wow. Do you think if you were poor, your friends would still come and visit you and see you? I hope so. So he decided he needed to eat, so he was starving to death. So he went to work on this pig farm, okay, and he was feeding pigs. And guess what he was eating?
Pig food.
Pig food, yeah.
Yeah!
Yeah, really. And so as he's sitting there, he's thinking, you know, I'm sitting here eating pig food, and at my dad's house, even my dad's servants are eating better than me. So he said, I'm going to go back and ask my dad to forgive me. So he did. He went back, and just what do you suppose his dad said? What would your dad say if you came back?
Why did you come back?
Why did you come back? Yeah, he might have said that. But his dad was so excited to see him. He just wrapped his arms around him, gave him a big hug, said, oh, we're going to have a party. We're going to celebrate that you're back. What do you suppose the older brother, who had stayed home and done all the work and everything, thought about that? No, what do you think he did? Do you have any idea? He was not happy, was he? No, because he said, that's not fair. Have you ever said that's not fair?
Yes.
A bunch of times, yeah. Well, things in life aren't always fair, are they? But the point of this whole story is what? That God loves you, no matter if you do something he doesn't want you to do.
I said it's not fair because our mom doesn't have to clean our room, but we do.
She thinks that's fair or not fair?
No.
Oh, you think you should have to clean your own, or your mom should have to clean your room?
Oh,
all right, anyways, so we're going to end this. Sit still. Okay, so let's say a prayer, okay? And let's be glad about God being able to take us back. Dear God, sometimes we make bad choices. Thank you for taking us back when we come and ask you for forgiveness. Amen.
Thank you so much, Suzanne. Thank you so much.
Friends, let's take a moment to greet our neighbors and share signs of Christ's peace and reconciliation. The peace of Christ be with you. Please share signs of Christ's peace with your neighbors.
you're visiting this morning, you'll find around the sanctuary prayer cards and communication cards. We'd love to know how we can be praying for you this week. We'd love to have some contact information so we can keep in touch, and you can return all of those cards and the offering plates when they go around this morning. I direct your attention to the interior of your bulletin, where you will find some of the work that our land acknowledgement team has been doing, helping us with ways to lift up that the First United Methodist Church of Eugene is located on Kalapuya Ilihi, the traditional indigenous homeland of the Kalapuya people. And we grieve the history of trauma that the indigenous peoples of Oregon have suffered due to the unjust practices of our government and the complicity of Christians. And we commit to making a better shared future together. You'll hear more about the good work that's been done by our land acknowledgement team, and they have more content available for you to check out in the North Lobby. Their next meeting is coming up on May 16th. And today is Native American Ministry Sunday, one of the six special Sundays that are honored across the denomination, a special giving opportunity that we support. And so there's a special envelope in your bulletins this morning for that purpose. And I think we have a short video from the denomination about today's special offering. Thank you, friends in the sound booth.
Did you know when you donate to the Native American Ministry Sunday offering, you support ministry programs to voice the Native Americans' diverse culture, seminary scholarships for United Methodist Native Americans, and committees on Native American ministries. Native American Ministry Sunday calls us to recognize and support the contributions of Native Americans to the church and society. Donations collected allow us to collaborate with existing Native American ministries and support seminary scholarships for United Methodist Native Americans. The Conference Committee on Native American Ministry administers these funds, and 50% of the offering remains in your annual conference to equip and empower local congregations. Help us develop and strengthen Native American ministries. Your gift helps our ministry advocate and share the history and traditions of Native peoples. Give in person, by mail, or online at umc.org/ssgive.
I'll share a little bit more about this all in the sermon, but our denomination has something that's called the NACP, not the NAACP. We all know that one. This is the NACP, which stands for the Native American Comprehensive Plan, which has four priorities: the preservation of indigenous languages, the preservation of indigenous spirituality, supporting the ministries of indigenous women, and addressing the unique impact of climate change on indigenous communities. So again, in the sermon, I'll share a little bit more about that, but I hope you'll consider making a special gift today in recognition of Native American Ministry Sunday. As we come now to our time for prayer, we give thanks for Bishop Cedric's presence with us this past Sunday. Keep Bishop in your prayers as he travels to North Carolina this week to participate in the lead-up to General Conference meetings. We love to celebrate people in this place and acknowledge birthdays when we can, and so we give thanks for Larry Go Ducks Newby, who has a birthday 1 week from today, I think, Virginia, if that's right. He's not with us as he's recovering from a bit of a blood clot adventure. So keep Larry in your prayers. He's recovering at home and no doubt driving Virginia crazy. And we give thanks for his birthday in 1 week's time. Kay James has a birthday this week, I believe, as does Pamela Nelson Munson, who we remember so fondly. And the great Sparky Rice is celebrating a birthday this week also. Sparky, happy birthday. Prayers for Sam Waligumbe, who had a bit of a health scare
this week, but is recovering and is back with us this morning helping out. Prayers for Ruth Gates in the loss of her brother. I was told this morning that Donna Strickland died on April 6th. She is in our membership directory. I did not have much relationship with Donna Strickland, so we'll be reaching out to the family to see if there are arrangements coming together that we can be supportive of. I received a note here to keep Carol and Dwayne Hildebrand in your prayers as they have COVID. Darn it. Hopefully they recover expeditiously. Last week I had to share with you the sad news that Nancy Fadley had passed away. And a service is being planned for Nancy on July 11th, which is her birthday. It seems very good and fine. Today I have to share with you that Barbara Kensler has passed away. I know. A remarkable artist. We give her credit for many of the banners that hang in our sanctuary all the year round. She designed coloring books. I have several of her coloring books in my office. And she wrote the nicest cards and notes, even as her vision started to fail and she really struggled to get to church. She had a brief stay over at the Pete Moore house after experiencing a bad fall. And I am meeting with the family this week and will keep you apprised of plans to celebrate Barbara. We also received word that Linda Newman passed away, and Linda was a helper at the annual United Women in Faith Bazaar. And we're working to connect with Linda's family. Jane Bailey Brinkman has passed away. And Jane was a member of the United Women in Faith Reading Group for many years. And I'm meeting with her family on Thursday. And I'm declaring a moratorium on passing away. No more for a minute, friends. We're a people of the resurrection. Goodness gracious. Much to hold on our hearts. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the way of peace. We thank you that you judge us not by the perfection of our actions, but by our readiness to live boldly by faith. We come to you as your children, humbled by our transgressions, and we ask your forgiveness. May your spirit of gentleness renew our sense of compassion and our willingness to serve. Our hearts carry the heaviness of loved ones lost. We pray for the Gates family and the Strickland family. We pray for the family and friends of Nancy Fadley, Barbara Kensler, Jane Bailey Brinkman, and Linda Newman. May your spirit of peace surround all those who mourn this day. Soften our hearts and strengthen us to care for our neighbors. Shape us in your image to be a people of the resurrection as you have broken the power of sin and death in our lives. God, you are merciful and gracious, endlessly patient, loving and true. We are forgiven our iniquity, our transgressions, and our sins. And so we pray as our Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And as our ushers help to receive our morning tithes and offerings, God, we marvel at how you are at work in our lives, and we call to mind the many blessings for which we are thankful. May our gifts support your church and our ministries near and far. For the sake of your Son and his great love for the world, amen. Our scripture lesson this morning is from the Gospel of Luke. You can follow along at page 91 of the New Testament in your pew Bibles. And this reading is from chapter 23, beginning in the 36th verse. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy, they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of the scriptures. Amen. It was a good thing to have the bishop with us here last week. He preached from the story of Doubting Thomas. And there is a thread that connects that appearance story and the appearance story that we just heard today. Last week's story about Thomas's experience comes from the Gospel of John and Thomas's experience with the risen Christ. And today's story from Luke, it is as if Jesus is trying to respond to those who dismiss his presence by labeling him a ghost, as if that wouldn't also be a little remarkable, but not remarkable enough for Jesus, as he makes clear, he is not a ghost. The resurrection is not that. Luke seems very concerned with demonstrating that Jesus is not a ghost, but it can be a difficult thing to find connective tissue between the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of John. Indeed, that is a challenge with any of Matthew, Mark, and Luke in finding connections with the Gospel of John. John is somewhat famous for doing his own thing. But something that both of these texts share is the description of Jesus' greeting to the disciples when he appears. We heard it last week and we heard it again this week. Jesus greets the disciples with the phrase, "Peace be with you." When Jesus finds his disciples, his friends, hiding behind locked doors, he wishes them peace. Peace be with you. Jesus doesn't judge them or admonish them for hiding in that moment. There is an appreciation of the danger they are all in and the persecution that they will come to experience. Jesus will send them out to do ministry in a very difficult and hard world. And we, each of us, are sent out to do ministry in a very difficult and hard world. Peace be with you. Yesterday was the Oregon-Idaho Annual Conference's legislative assembly, which is an exercise that I get to help with every year. Thanks be to God. Each year, the United Methodists of Oregon and Idaho gather for an annual conference, and this year it is in Tigard. Am I saying that right? Tigard? Thank you. Thank you. It's been 9 years, but I still check. And every year, petitions are submitted to annual conference. A petition might be a proposal for us to take some sort of action together. Or a petition might be a statement of our values in response to a social concern. So annual conference will meet up in Tigard later this June. Yesterday was the legislative assembly that meets before annual conference and works on those petitions. Works with the authors to improve them, get things organized for conference. It was scheduled to be a 5-hour Zoom meeting. We got it done in 4. But anyone ever heard of the meeting after the meeting? Anybody ever heard of that? Wasted that hour we saved, let me tell you. Just burned it right up. It's all right. There are many interesting petitions for annual conference to consider this year. There are some statements about our commitment to peace and calling us to share with our elected leaders our belief that the United States should be doing more to work for peace between the people of Israel and the Palestinian people. There is a proposal to encourage local churches with foundations to divest their portfolios of fossil fuel-connected stocks and assets. We have a foundation here at this church, and for years it has operated with very restrictive screens that have kept us out of many ethically problematic investments, including the fossil fuel sector. And generally, with those tight investment screens, the foundation of your church has consistently outperformed the market average. So there's a proposal going to annual conference that would encourage more local churches to divest from those assets. There's an interesting proposal that would encourage every local church to have on hand 2 doses of Narcan or some other overdose reversal agent. Serving a downtown church, that is a proposal that I'm watching closely. It's not difficult to imagine someone coming in on a Sunday and having an overdose crisis here in our midst. And with a relatively simple to administer medication like Narcan, a life might be saved. We are each of us called to do ministry in a very difficult and hard world. Downtown Eugene has its challenges. The scale of need can feel overwhelming, to the point that churches might be asked to have overdose reversal agents on hand. Can we muster the strength to be kind even when it is really, really hard to be kind? Say amen or say ouch.
Ouch.
Ouch, right? Come on. But we are each of us called to do ministry in a very difficult and hard world. Peace be with you. Bishop Bridgeforth presided over yesterday's legislative assembly and shared with us that this week he heads to Charlotte, North Carolina to prepare for the coming general conference. So every year, the United Methodists from Oregon, Idaho, we get together for an annual conference, but only every 4 years does the general conference gather. That general conference impacts the lives of the entire global United Methodist Church, all the 12 million or so people called United Methodist. And because of the COVID pandemic, it has been 8 years since a regular meeting of the General Conference has happened. So after worship last week, Bishop shared with us some of his hopes and concerns for what might or might not get accomplished at General Conference when it meets here in just a couple weeks. I thought his sermon was a great introduction to who our bishop is and the faith journey that has brought him this far. And he shared some interesting insights into the relationship between John and Thomas. He made reference to an apocryphal document known as the Gospel of Thomas. Gospel of Thomas. Anyone here ever read the Gospel of Thomas? Yeah, sure. Yep. It's easy to get a hold of. It's very Googleable. It's an interesting collection of sayings and parables. There are some familiar sayings in there. It's in the Gospel of Thomas. You read, Jesus said, blessed are the poor, for yours is the kingdom of heaven. That sounds familiar. Then there's this one. The disciples said to Jesus, tell us what the kingdom of heaven is like. And Jesus said to them, it's like a mustard seed. It's the smallest of all seeds, but when it falls on tilled soil, it produces a great plant and becomes a shelter for birds of the sky. Again, we've heard mustard seed metaphors before. Okay, good, good, good. There are also some strange sayings in the Gospel of Thomas, friends. And the structure of it, too, is also very different from the four Gospels we've come to know, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And you can see why Thomas was not ultimately included in the Bibles that so many churches use. So in Bible study this morning after worship, we'll spend some time with the Gospel of Thomas. Not only the things that are familiar, but some of the things that are real outliers in that document compared to the scripture we know so well. So we'll meet down in the library for that after worship. And we usually get started by about 11:15. All are welcome to come be a part of that. And next week in worship, we will be praying for our bishop, for our delegation, and for all our leaders who will gather at General Conference in Charlotte. In sharing a word of hope with us this last Sunday, Bishop Sedgwick reminded us that the unthinkable, the unimaginable, cannot stop God. And I understand that some folk are discouraged by the behavior of the United Methodist Church. It can feel so difficult, even impossible, to make progress where we know we need to make progress. But even if we struggle to imagine how on earth we are going to make things better, our lack of imagination will not hold back God. We believe God is on the side of the good, on the side of peace. God is on the side of justice. But one of the worst feelings there is to hope for something, to really hope for something, and to then be disappointed. That does not feel good. And we've been down that road with previous General Conferences. Many of us here cheer for the various Oregon Duck sports teams. We know what it is to hope and have big hopes, to be disappointed. I grew up cheering for the Chicago Cubs baseball team. Pray for me still. No. Back then, they didn't even have much hope, so it really wasn't that disappointing. But it doesn't feel good to be hopeful and to then be disappointed. There's vulnerability in that. If you let yourself hope, really hope. And I'll share more next week about being hopeful for this year's gathering of the General Conference. The unthinkable, the unimaginable, it cannot stop God. Now, friends, as we heard earlier in worship today is the United Methodist annual observance of Native American Ministry Sunday. And last year, on this Sunday, we explored the idea of our church working on a land acknowledgement statement And that team has been working, as you've seen in your bulletins. And again, there's some material in the North Lobby if you'd like to look at that. I'm really grateful for the work of that team. The description that the denomination gives us for this Sunday is interesting, and it reads in part that a gap in knowledge exists in the United Methodist Church, in congregations and other United Methodist entities relative to comprehending concepts of Native American life and culture, languages, values, and contemporary challenges. And it is important to understand the history we are a part of when we gather for worship in this place and understand the unjust treatment of indigenous people upon which our entire community is built. And then it is reasonable to ask, what action will come from this understanding? And there are, I found, three quick little relatively soon action opportunities for you to hold on your hearts and with good discernment perhaps put on your calendars. And let's see, I think I've got a little slide here with a few of those. Yep, good. That first one is this Saturday. It's April 20th. It's over on campus at their Museum of Natural and Cultural History. Who's been over to that little building? They've got it's a great visit over to that building. And the conversation that's happening there Saturday is entitled Rethinking Land Acknowledgements. It's all about taking that next step. That after we work on the land acknowledgement and do the consciousness-raising work that's essential and so important, then what actions can come out of that? And that conversation is going to be led by, her name is Steph Littlebird, an Indigenous artist who's going to help us examine how to go beyond the statement. So that conversation is going to happen at 1 o'clock. On Saturday over on campus. I think that's a great and important opportunity. And then a little later in May, the River Road Rec Center, out kind of on the way to the parsonage, is going to host author David Lewis, who wrote a book entitled The Tribal Histories of the Willamette Valley. So this is good local history for us to be engaging with and hearing about. And that is May 11th, and that's an evening event. The Saturday's at 1, and this is at 6. I'll have these out here in the North Lobby if you want to take a look at these programs coming up. And then your land acknowledgement team here at the church is meeting on Thursday, May 16th. And so these are three opportunities to begin to really enflesh a statement with some action. When you attend programs like these, many of you have attended programs like these, the presentations have value, but so does the relationship that happens with the person you're sitting next to in the room. Often more can come out of that unexpected relationship than came out of the talk that you were there to engage with. Who's had that experience before? Where, my goodness, I forgot what the talk was about, but I went to that talk and I met that. That's what happens when you go to a United Women in Faith district meeting and you meet somebody new, and you may have heard a great presentation, but more comes out of that new relationship than you ever could have dreamed of. And if you don't open yourself up to going to the event, the relationship never happens. So I commend these programs to you. I'm going to try to go to the Saturday one over on campus. I think that's a really interesting opportunity that I don't know when will be repeated. But this work is hard work. Each of us are called to do ministry in a difficult and hard world. Peace be with you. And last night at dinner, I watched on television the rockets flying through the night sky over Israel. Scary business. War is awful. And doubly so because war then makes every other awful thing possible. It not only takes lives from violence, but then war leads to famine, to disease, and to poverty. And now we're seeing how this war between Israel and Hamas has the potential to widen and draw in more nations and more combatants. Peace feels impossible, and war feels so inevitable. And yet, the unthinkable, the unimaginable cannot stop God. So I invite you now to join me as we take a moment to pray. God of us all, Prince of Peace, this season feels so uncertain. So much seems to hang in the balance. And while we struggle as a divided people, war rages. And as the world's leaders convene and work and plot and plan, may the good that is peace guide their decisions, even a little bit. Soften hearts to protect the people, to at every opportunity lay down arms, to at every opportunity let go of vengeance and hate. Stir in these leaders a hunger for peace. And strengthen us to be a people who stand on the side of peace as we work for that day when spears are turned into pruning hooks, swords into plowshares, and the people learn war no more. Amen. Each of us is called to do ministry in a difficult and hard world. And when the brokenness of that world feels too big, may we find a way to bring some small comfort to those who are struggling in our midst. Peace be with you. Amen. Friends, let's stand and sing together our hymn of response. It's number 306 in your hymnals, if you'd like the music. And the title, "The Strife Is O'er, The Battle Done." Lord, let it be so. Let's sing together number 306. You may be seated. Just a couple of reminders. Next week, we have a wonderful Concerts at First program here at the church, 3 p.m. Here in the sanctuary, and there are more details about that in the north lobby out here, and it'll be in the emails that go around to the church as well. Hope you can linger with us for a few moments in the fellowship hall for some coffee and refreshments and conversation, and then we'll have Bible study down in the library about 11:15 this morning. Hear this blessing. Because the tomb is empty, your life can be full. And so go into every place and every day as people brimming with the love of God. Be graceful in spirit, hopeful in word, faithful in deed. Live for the risen Christ as Christ lives in you. Have a blessed week. Amen.